Yes, you can start.
Good evening, everyone. I, Saloni Charasia, second year undergrad student, welcome you to the 8th lecture in Coherence Lecture Series organized by Team Decoherence, which is a part of Pravega 2021. In this lecture series, we will hear from renowned physicists who are actively involved in research in particular areas of physics, so that everyone gets introduced to the various areas in physics and ongoing research methodologies in those areas. Today, we have very renowned physicist, Professor Rama Govindarajan with us. She is professor at the International Center for Theoretical Sciences, Tata Institute of Fundamental Research, Bangalore. She did her undergraduate degree, BTech, in Chemical Engineering from IIT Delhi. She got her master's degree in chemical engineering from Drexel University, United States in 1986. Her doctoral degree, PhD, thesis is on the subject of aerospace engineering from the Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. So she's alumni of our institute as well. Her research area is fluid dynamics with emphasis on instabilities and the transition of to turbulence, cloud floats and particulate flows. She is awarded with the most notable the Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award for the year 2007. She was also awarded with the Young Scientist Award of 1987. She received the CNR Rao Oration Award of 2004 at JNCASR Bangalore. And what not? She is also a part of Leelavati Daughters, which is a collection of nearly 100 biographical essays on women scientists of India, published by Indian Academy of Sciences, Bangalore in 2008. I would recommend you to please have a look once. Well, her website talks about the science she does. Today, Prof. Rama Govindarajan will talk about particulate flows and flows where viscosity varies in space and time, and describes some of her group's research work. She will also outline what's exciting about these and lot of questions about flows need answering. Before I hand over the virtual stage to Professor Govindarajan, I would like to request a wonderful audience to kindly use Q&A box for any queries they have. The questions will be taken up by the moderators. So without a further ado, I would like to request Professor Rama to please address us. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Saloni. And thank you to the entire team of Decoherence for this opportunity. I'm very, very happy to speak here. Obviously, I cannot outline everything in flow that can be studied, but my summary is that anything in flows can be studied. The point is that fluid dynamics is a very old field, so any problem you touch will probably have been studied in the 1800s, in the 1900s, and in the 2000s. But and typically a new student who starts looking at this field gets the feeling that, oh, a lot is done and there's very few questions left for me. So that is very, very untrue. Like, a huge number of most important questions are left to be studied, and that is my theme for today. Of course, I'll only outline one or two such things. Now, are you able to see my second screen?
Yes.
Okay. So, any student of physics or engineering, the minute they hear fluid dynamics, they go to the word turbulence, and a lot of buildup has been given about turbulence. All of you would have seen that these strange claims, one of them is that it's the last unsolved problem of classical physics. And there is also this famous quote, which is purported. I don't think it was a real quote, but of Heisenberg on his deathbed. By the way, you should read about, you know, what happened during his PhD to him. But on his deathbed, he's supposed to have said, when I meet God, I'm going to ask him two questions, why relativity and why turbulence, and God will have an answer for the first. Of course, like, besides most likely being a lie, this quote also presumes that God is male and God exists. So yeah, So I would like to move away from this kind of build up to turbulence. Fluid dynamics is another field like any field. Turbulence is another problem like any hard problem. It's a very hard and beautiful problem, and there's many more problems in fluid dynamics which don't have to do directly with turbulence. So it's kind of this kind of buildup is what I'd like to move away from, and to call it an unsolved problem is also kind of misnomer, because parts of it are understood, parts of it are solved. There are other parts where there are still big questions. So the creature that we normally call turbulence, and physicists always study, is called homogeneous isotropic turbulence. And we will come to what this is, but this has been pretty well studied at moderate Reynolds numbers. And I will also describe what Reynolds number is. So this is one aspect that some amount of understanding is already there in the field in. And then today I'd like to focus on where the big open questions are. Shear turbulence is almost open to be understood. And everywhere in real life there is shear. So shear turbulence is an extremely important daily life phenomenon that needs to be understood. There's always transitions from laminar to turbulent, turbulent to laminar. Such transitions take place in so many situations every day. And these are pretty poorly understood. They're beginning to get nicely understood, and very nice new methods are coming up, which I will try to describe. If you have turbulence in which there are solid particles, droplets, other things going on, this actually changes the answer, changes the turbulence, and these are like not very well understood at all. And then there is stratified flow. So for example, in the ocean, salinity is not the same from place A to place B. Temperatures not the same. Various compositions vary. Again, in the atmosphere, temperature, pressure, all these things vary grossly from one place to another. So such flows are poorly understood, even without turbulence and also with turbulence. Now, the important thing about such big problems is that it's very hard to live in an analytical world. So you can do analytical, beautiful analytical things, but you do need computations. You need large computations, and these are very, very hard to do, and I'll come to why that's the case. Okay, so when we talk about fluid mechanics, what is the simplest way we can move forward? So of course, all of you have heard about the Navier-Stokes equations. So in order to get at the Navier-Stokes equations, we make the following assumptions. First of all, you see in this thing, are you able to see my cursor?
Yes.
Okay. So like here is a little blob of fluid which I've drawn very big. And this little blob of fluid contains lots and lots of molecules. And we know that each of them is going in a straight line with some velocity pulled out of a Maxwell-Boltzmann distribution. And these guys are dashing against each other and changing their direction. This is for an ideal gas, but things are similar in liquids. So then so each of them is moving at an enormous velocity in air, the typical speed is 330 or something meters per second. The speed of sound. So they're moving really, really fast. But then each molecule is moving with something pulled out of a Maxwell-Boltzmann plus a small epsilon velocity u. U is very small compared to this 300 meter per second. Typically in most daily life flows, u is like meters per second or even slower. So then this is not true, of course, in supersonic flows and things like that. So then when we take this U to be small and we take this blob to be big enough that it contains a very large number of molecules, but small enough that we can describe a particular U. So now this U comes as a response to various external pressure, external forces like pressure. Now pressure comes out of Maxwell-Boltzmann, but the forward velocity comes out of variations in pressure from one place to another. So you make this approximation of continuum where you say, I'll take a blob of fluid, I will throw away this part, and I will only consider the velocity u because that's the average velocity with which this blob is moving forward. And the next approximation we're going to make in today's talk is that flow is incompressible. And this becomes untrue when things reach the speed of sound. So we are in a very, very subsonic limit. And in that limit, this is a very fair assumption to make. So this is just a divergence-free velocity because the flow is incompressible. We will also talk of this thing called the kinematic viscosity nu, which will be a function of temperature and composition alone. And so this is basically a Newtonian fluid. So in each of these, you know, there are situations in fluid mechanics where these assumptions don't hold. For example, if I want to understand polymeric flow, I should not be making this assumption. If I want to understand supersonic flow, I should not be making this assumption. If I want to study re-entry vehicles coming in from outer space, I should not even be making this assumption. So then to make life easy, we make all these assumptions. And for the most part of today, we'll talk about the kinematic viscosity being a constant. Now, it's very, very hard to move forward in fluid mechanics without defining the Reynolds number, so I'll define it here. It's a non-dimensional number which has a characteristic velocity of the flow capital U, which is some measure of this small u, okay, in this case. And then a characteristic length scale D or L, whatever you may call it, divided by the kinematic viscosity. The kinematic viscosity is the ratio of normal viscosity, dynamic viscosity, divided by the fluid density. Okay, so this is a non-dimensional number called the Reynolds number. And now, like for this blob of fluid, I can write a force balance. So it's not like a solid object which is, you know, under one body force or two body forces. It's a blob of fluid which is forced by everybody else in the neighborhood. So there's so many blobs which are all forcing each other, and then there are boundaries, there are pressure gradients. So if you write the force balance for such a thing, it's called the Navier-Stokes equations. And I've written it in constant viscosity and in non-dimensional form. So I get a 1 over Reynolds number here, which is actually the viscous term. So if I set viscosity to 0, this term would go away. So this is the Navier-Stokes equation. So this is the simplest thing we can use to study most flows, and we will go forward with this one. As you know, it's not simple, the Navier-Stokes. We discussed the Reynolds number in the previous slide, and I said this is a very, very important number. So it actually denotes the ratio of inertial forces to viscous forces. So like wherever inertia is large, the Reynolds number is large. Wherever viscosity is the dominant thing, the Reynolds number is low. Okay, so here all we've done is keep a sphere fixed and given flow past it at a certain Reynolds number, at a certain velocity. And the size of the sphere gives a length scale, so we have a Reynolds number. So when, you know, there is flow past the sphere at low Reynolds number, below 300, you either get no flow structure behind it, or you get some simple, nice looking patterns behind it. These are actually vorticity peeling off. The curl of the velocity vector is shown here. So you get, you know, some vortices being shed behind the sphere, and simple things like this happen. When you increase the Reynolds number to around 1000, you see like a much more complicated, you know, kind of vortex shedding going on. But still you see that there is some periodicity. It's very three-dimensional, very messy, but still I can see some level of periodicity in this shedding. Whereas if I go to a Reynolds number of the order of 10 to the power 4, you see that the flow behind the sphere is extremely turbulent. This is what we call turbulence. And here the vorticity, that means the curl of the velocity vector is shown in color. You can see it's extremely messy. There are structures at lots of different length scales. Already you see visually what you believe to be turbulence. Your intuition of turbulence comes through here. So the Reynolds number, as it goes higher and higher, you're more likely to get more interesting, more complicated dynamics, and you're likely to go into something like fully developed turbulence. However, it's not a simple case of, you know, no shedding and then rushing to turbulence. It's not like that. There's a whole series of events that keep happening as you increase the Reynolds number, and a whole bunch of instability. So this is coming out of an instability, this comes out of a secondary instability, and so on. So there's a process which takes you to turbulence as you increase the Reynolds number. Okay, so I said physicists normally study homogeneous isotropic turbulence. This is because anything else is most complicated. It's not because it's the right thing to study or whatever. But A, anything else is more complicated, and B, by studying this, you do get some insights. You do get some very important insights. So normally when you look at the word turbulence, you will associate it with all of these connected other adjectives. It's chaotic, it's unpredictable, it's aperiodic, highly nonlinear, and because it's chaotic, it's sensitive to initial conditions. Everything that applies to a standard chaotic system will apply to turbulence. There is mixing, there are strange attractors, there's multifractal behavior. All of this goes with the, standard things in chaos theory that you see in any chaotic process. But I would like to point out here that turbulence, A, should not be thought of as something random. It's not, it's got like, you know, lots of apparent randomness, but there's a lot that's not random in it. And secondly, it's very vortical. So the vorticity, which is the curl of the velocity vector I defined previously, this thing is very high in certain parts. So A, it's vertical, and B, it shows structures. So you don't see some random mess like this is Jason's simulation. Jason is, he was in our group and now he's a faculty member in IIT Bombay. So in the red color, don't worry about the blue. In the red color, he shows regions of very high vorticity. So you see that these regions of very high vorticity are not randomly, random dots all over the landscape. They're kind of organized in little rod-like things. So inside each of these rods, the fluid is spinning like crazy. So these are highly rotational tubes that you see over here. So these actually occupy a small fraction of the entire space. And the higher you go in intensity, the smaller the fraction of space it occupies. And this is known as intermittency. We know this happens, but we don't understand it. So there's like big open questions in homogeneous isotropic turbulence as well. So let me, before continuing, define homogeneous and isotropic. What we have here, when I say something is homogeneous, I mean, if I look at this part of the fluid, on an average, it will behave exactly like that part of the fluid. So if I wait long enough, I'll see behavior like that over here and so on. So on an average, if I wait for a long time, I cannot distinguish this part from that part or from that part. So every part of this box is the same as every other part. Isotropic means if I look in any direction on an average, again, I will not see a difference. So like the primary, there's no primary direction, there's no special behavior in any of these coordinates. So it's homogeneous and isotropic. So here is a good place for me to stop for a minute if somebody has questions.
Not anything at the moment.
Sorry?
Yeah, no, we don't have any question at the moment. Yeah, okay. You can continue.
Okay, I'll continue. So far, is it clear or I should go slower or faster?
I think it's fine.
Okay, yes, it's okay. Okay, so now we talked about homogeneous isotropic turbulence, but almost any flow that you see in real life is not homogeneous, it's not isotropic. In other words, like, look at this. This is a model. Do you see the India map there? There's India and there's Sri Lanka. And, this is the Bay of Bengal. And in this place, you see the Ganga and Brahmaputra. They're disgorging. And so you see in color, what you're seeing is salinity. So then, like, it's very, very fresh there and it's very, very salty over here. So this is the Bay of Bengal. Anything that happens to the ocean affects the atmosphere. Anything that happens to the atmosphere affects the ocean. There's clouds, there's movement of clouds, there's turbulence in the ocean, there's regions of not turbulence in the ocean. So a lot of drama is going on. So if I draw a box here and say it's homogeneous, that's going to be wrong. This place is different from this place. This place is different from this place. So it's absolutely not homogeneous. Is it isotropic? It actually isn't. So I took this picture of this musambi, okay? It's like the citrus fruit. So if you take the earth, then this whole region, the atmosphere, the oceans are 4 kilometers deep. The atmosphere is 10 kilometers big for all our practical, weather considerations. This thing is thinner than this inner peel of the Musambi in relation to the earth. So it's like this very, very, very thin sleeve that's sitting on top. So clearly it's not isotropic. There's a big difference between the vertical direction and the other two directions. So you can get eddies here, which are thousands of kilometers in this dimension, but a few meters in that dimension, just a few tens of meters in that dimension. So all kinds of, behavior can happen, which cannot be studied under any assumption of isotropy, except maybe if you go to the tiniest scale, then you'll see all the things we learn about homogeneous isotropic turbulence at play. So at very, very small scales, you'll see things are isotropic, things are homogeneous. And whenever it's not isotropic and not homogeneous, the fundamental physics changes from whatever we've understood of turbulence up to now. So if you want to understand turbulent flows in the atmosphere and in the oceans, and a lot of these flows are always turbulent, and if you want to understand when they stop being turbulent or any such thing, you need to study it differently. Another point I want to tell you, I already told you that turbulence is vortical. There's a lot of structure in it. Now, this is flow past a solid plate. It's just flow past a solid plate. And in color, you see the vorticity. And you see the vorticity is organized in the form of these hairpin-like structures. It's not completely random. It's not that vorticity is just, any number in any place. So if I chose white noise, it's absolutely not going to look like vorticity. So vorticity has this typical hairpin structure near the wall. So even if, my lecture is not reaching you, you're getting bored, you've fallen off asleep, whatever it is, please wake up for this 1 minute. And if you listen to this thing, that turbulence has a lot of structure in it. It's, it's unpredictable, it's chaotic, it's blah, 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 but there's instantaneously a lot of structure in it, and these structures keep changing from microsecond to microsecond or whatever. But if you just remember that turbulence has structure in it, then it's okay if you didn't get the rest of the lecture whatsoever. Okay, and just like any chaotic process, in any chaotic process there'll be sub processes which are purely periodic of all kinds of periods. Most complicated periodic orbits have been found in turbulence, and this is a complete ball game which I don't play, but it's a very, very interesting ball game which many people play. Another point is that shear is everywhere. That means the velocity, there's a mean velocity typically in one direction. It's not isotropic, and this velocity varies from place to place. So there's a velocity gradient. So shear is everywhere, wherever you look in real life. Okay, and this kind of very complicated and very messy process has its unfortunate side. The unfortunate side is that all these facts, the fact that there's hairpin vortices, the fact that there's so many of them, the fact that there's this and that, any kind of average property you want to pull out, you need very big simulations. That means solutions of the direct solutions of the Navier-Stokes. You also need very detailed experiments. Typically in these situations, simulations lead. and experiments follow in all of these basic understanding level things, because experiments are very, very hard to set up and very, very hard to do. There's also lots of room for theory. This is the point I want to make. There's lots of room for analytical work, but you will need to hang those analytical results on things you know from simulations and experiment. Okay, so what is shear? So here I have two plates and this channel is rotating. This is just one example where you have, you know, this kind of parabolic velocity profile. So the velocity, it's a pressure driven flow through this channel and there's a parabolic velocity profile. So the pressure is high here and low here. So there's flow through this channel. And because of no slip boundary conditions, the velocity is zero at the walls. And this whole channel is rotating. We just studied this problem to see what happens to a big channel on a rotating earth. So, you know, whenever you see these turbulent structures, they all look like a royal mess and you feel, oh, if it's so chaotic, so aperiodic, so unpredictable, what am I getting after? Why am I studying this? If I can't predict anything, I can't calculate anything right, I can't do anything. That is actually not true. We can actually get many mean properties very accurately. So in these four pictures, what I'm trying to show is the following. We change the amount of rotation. This is low rotation, higher, higher, higher. So as you go to somewhat intermediate rotation, you see a very messy thing where the structures don't have some particular shape. Again, like these structures, I won't explain what we plotted, but it's some measure of where the vorticity has reached one particular value. So you see how we can get the mean flow right. So then you see these complicated structures. At a higher rotation, you see more organization in the structures. And at even higher rotation, you see a huge amount of, you know, organization where now these vortices have become long tubes which are sitting at the bottom of the channel. So a lot of these changes happen. This flow is not so completely turbulent, but this one and this one are rather turbulent. And you'll see that in each case, if I draw the mean velocity profile, I get a perfectly repeatable shape, like so long as I average it well enough. And that shape of the velocity profile depends on the rotation. So I can actually understand something about this flow in the mean by doing simulations. So we can understand how much is going to be the drag. We can understand a whole variety of things from getting the mean flow right. So, and we can get other features also apart from the mean. We can get facts which actually are going to be repeatable from experiment to experiment. Okay, so now if we want to solve the problem of cloud cover in the atmosphere, this is just an example of what the clouds look like. Incidentally, you'll see that, you know, India gets covered by cloud once every year in the monsoon season. It's so beautifully repeatable. But you can see that it's a hugely messy process. And now if you say, okay, I want to simulate all clouds in the atmosphere by Navier-Stokes equation, let me tell you right away, it's not possible. You cannot simulate all clouds by Navier-Stokes, and we'll come to why. We'll come to why, but what we do first, I'll tell you. You need to follow this thing called the multi-scale approach, where first you run the Navier-Stokes at very, very small scales, and then with the Navier-Stokes results, you form what are called subgrid scale models, and you use these to force, you know, like in the Navier-Stokes equation, every scale influences every other scale. So you use this to force the bigger scales. So whatever the small scales are doing to the big scales, you can model that by first solving at small scales. You apply the correct forces on an average, and then you perform, you know, these things called large eddy simulations, bigger simulations, and then you make observations. You use the results from these large eddy simulations and observations, and you actually make parameters by hand. And you put these parameters back into these global models, which, you know, give you big weather predictions or whatever. So these contain a lot of, you know, ad hoc and also empirical things given from one scale to another. And these things are typically not good for every part of the world. They're not good for every situation. And so like these global models have a lot, I mean, they really, really suffer from a lot of things we don't know at the small scale. So there's problems going from there to there and there to there. So whenever in this multi-scale approach, everything here is full of open questions. So now let's talk about a single cloud. Let's just go very far down in space and say, look, I can see one puff of cloud in the atmosphere up there in the sky. So can I simulate that one? The answer is you still cannot. So like if I want to do a single cloud fluid dynamics, I want to act, and there's like raindrops here which are all falling and other things are happening in the cloud. It's very turbulent. It's full of, you know, aerosol particles, raindrops, whatever. I can still solve only a small box in that cloud, and I'll tell you why. This is because everything depends on the Reynolds number. So suppose I take the entire cloud and I take my Navier-Stokes equation and I discretize my Navier-Stokes equation. Namely, I solve it at every grid location. And I take all the derivatives in discretized form and I'm solving it everywhere. So I make a three-dimensional grid like this. I mean, a cube with many little cubes in it. I make this three-dimensional grid and at each grid location, I solve the Navier-Stokes. If I'm going to do that well, then there is, you know, logic which I won't go into, which tells me that if the cloud has a size L and my grid has a size delta X, then I need at least as many grids as Reynolds to the power 3/4. I need that many grids as Reynolds to the power 3/4. In a cloud, the Reynolds number is 10 to the power 8, 10 to the power 9, single cloud. So then you will have Reynolds to the 3/4 as a million. So you need a million grids in this direction if I want to resolve everything that's happening at every scale. So basically, like if you take the Navier-Stokes, you Fourier transform it, you'll see that every scale forces every other scale. So I need to resolve the small scales, big scales, all these scales. If I want to do this, I need 1 million grid points in one direction. That means 10 to the power 18 grid points overall. And that's just for a single cloud. And the biggest simulation of turbulence today is on of the order of 10,000 grid points, not 1 million. It's a very, very small domain that we're solving. So it's 10,000 grid points being solved on lakhs and lakhs and lakhs of computers connected in parallel, cores connected in parallel. So you have many lakhs of cores which can solve a very small part of a cloud. So like in the near future, we don't see how we can just solve Navier-Stokes for the entire globe or anything even for a single cloud. We're nowhere near that. That's the point I want to say. And this is, the kind of grid that they solve. They solve this grid. In this grid, they typically solve without droplets. They just solve Navier-Stokes. But remember that there are droplets all over. There's about 10 to the power 9 tiny drops per meter cube of a cloud. So like there's 10 to the, when it's, you know, quite saturated and things in an Indian cumulus cloud. In another cloud, it may be, you know, 5 into 10 to the power 8 or something like that. But it's a very, very large number of tiny droplets in every meter cube of cloud. And you know how many meter cubes there are in a cloud. Each droplet can have its own Reynolds number. It could be very, very close to zero, or it could be as big as 10 to the power 4. So each droplet then needs to be understood. So like if the droplet is of the order of 10 to the power 4 Reynolds, that's like a 1 millimeter droplet. So this 1 millimeter droplet, it may not even be spherical because it's a droplet. But if I pretend that it's a sphere, then behind it, I'm going to get this turbulence. So I have to solve for each droplet. And so this grid won't be enough. This grid won't be enough. I have to make a very, very, very tiny grid around this thing and then resolve all these teeny, teeny vortices. And they're all forcing the rest of the flow. So like, if I want to solve it exactly, it's practically impossible for every droplet. Now, can I resolve each droplet's dynamics? The answer is no. And further, like, it's not just the 10 to the power 4 guys that are problematic. Even the 0 guys can be problematic. So this droplet dynamics is messy at any Reynolds number. And we actually did a lot of analytical work for the unsteady Stokes equation, which was basically at Reynolds equal to 0. And we actually came up with a method. Till now, people could, you know, they didn't even solve the 0 Reynolds number case accurately, the unsteady Stokes accurately, because there was a term called Bassett history term, which made it very, very, very enormous numerically to solve for each droplet, even at 0 Reynolds number. So even though the flow behind it looks simple, we couldn't solve it. We proposed some analytical methods, and we proposed semi-analytical methods in a turbulent situation where this can be solved quite a bit faster. It's still going to be a lot of work, and we're now trying to put it into real turbulence and see how we can at least resolve these very tiny particles. And then we should remember that these droplets are evaporating, condensing. Each time they evaporate or condense, there's latent heat, so the temperature changes in the atmosphere. So that part, wherever there's a lot of condensation, the buoyancy becomes, you know, very large. And so, like, you can have potential energy being released and overturnings. And we've shown that thermodynamics can change everything we know about turbulence. So, like, even this tiny part of a cloud, we don't understand. So that's the moral. And, like, now to go back to a bigger cloud and bigger cloud, it's going to be, you know, things for the future. So how to do this in a realistic way, how to understand things analytically in a broad sense, how to simplify the problem so that you can pull out the physics. There's so many questions here. So, like, the summary is, for something like this, where we want to understand, like, a monsoon cloud, like, when is it going to cover India, or when are we going to get normal rainfall this year, or what are we going to get? Good predictions are very far away, and good predictions combined with a physics understanding is even further away. So this is another good place to stop. Any questions you have?
Yeah, so we have one question on large ready stimulation. So the question is, do we have sufficient computer power for large eddy stimulation?
So, like, we have computer power for large eddy simulations of a certain size, but even those are not very big. For example, now people are doing large eddy simulations on a single cloud. So there's a group in Caltech which is doing that, and they also can't resolve very well, but they can do, like, you know, hundreds of meters, maybe up to a kilometer. So, like, we still can't use large eddy simulations to solve for the globe. We have to use, you know, models for that. In the large eddy simulations, you're solving for the large eddies exactly, and you're putting the forcing from the small eddies. And this is still, like, you know, and that's one thing, like, you can't go too big. And the other thing is that this forcing from the small scales can be completely wrong. It depends on the kind of cloud, whether there's thermodynamics going on. Those things we still don't have right. So does that answer the question?
Yeah. Okay. So another question is on turbulence. So the first question is the complete mathematical description of turbulence possible?
So basically, if you have, you know, a simple flow where there's constant viscosity, constant temperature, blah, 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 it's pretty well described by the Navier-Stokes, because the Navier-Stokes is a very good force balance for such a system where you have constant viscosity. I mean, where you can take this viscosity to be constant. So yes, I know the equation which I need to solve, but that equation is very, very non-linear. So it gives chaotic solutions. So you know that by the fundamental, property of any chaotic nonlinear equation, which is that if I start from an initial condition, that's ever so slightly wrong. So suppose I say this thing is isothermal and the temperature is 30 degrees. But suppose instead of 30 degrees, it was 30.00000001 in some places. So then, like, what will happen is I'm missing, you know, some small things that are happening there. And I'm missing something there. And at long times, the answer that I get will diverge from the true answer. So the closer and closer I get to the initial condition, the better and better I'll follow it to some degree. But even if I'm solving exactly for turbulence in a small box, but at some point I'm going to go wrong at some point in time. So my trajectories are going to diverge. Another thing is that all systems have, you know, these molecules running around. So when I call something as U, it's subject to these internal noises. And that can also take my answer away from the real answer. That can be enough to even transition from lamina to turbulence in some cases.
All right. So another question on turbulence. It's like when we say we don't understand turbulence, so what exactly we don't understand? The physics or the mathematics behind it?
We principally don't understand the physics behind it. And because we don't understand, I mean, we don't understand anything. Okay, we understand quite a lot. So wherever we understand the physics, we're able to put it in a new mathematical framework. These two things go hand in hand. For example, boundary layer turbulence. So the turbulence in an aircraft wing, just near an aircraft wing, that thing we can understand quite a bit of what's going on there. And that's because we've made big strides in mathematics, one of them being singular perturbation theory, which I will briefly mention. And such, you know, huge advances in mathematics have happened in order to answer the questions in fluid dynamics. I won't even say questions in turbulence, it's questions in fluid dynamics. So like great developments in maths have gone hand in hand with great understanding of the physics. Chaos theory itself is an example of, you know, when people try to understand flows of various kinds. It was, you know, highly motivated by fluid dynamics that we didn't understand. And similarly, singular perturbation. So these two things have gone hand in hand. So right now we have the mathematical framework. We don't understand the physics, but as we understand the physics, new maths comes out of it. Is this?
Yeah, it okay. Answered. So the next question. Yeah, so next question is, how can the droplet Reynolds number be nearly zero in a turbulent flow?
Very good question, very good question. So like the flow is very big. So the Reynolds number of the flow is some very big velocity U and a very big length scale D divided by the kinematic viscosity. Now, what does a droplet see? A droplet is like, you know, 0.1 of a millimeter, like actually, these small droplets are micron sized. So it is like a micron in size and it's moving with nearly the same velocity as the fluid. So relative to the fluid, its Reynolds number is practically zero. So like, because I define its Reynolds number based on the relative velocity between it and the fluid, you know, when the fluid is rushing, it drags the droplet with it. So there's very little relative velocity. The size is very small. So in terms of the droplet, actually, if I am a droplet and I'm sitting in a cloud or a very turbulent flow, I won't see turbulent flow. It will feel to me like I'm sitting in a very gooey, like very viscous honey-like thing. So air, which is moving so fast, to me is like honey, which is moving very slow. So in terms of the droplet and its physics, the Reynolds number is very, very small.
Yes, so I think we can continue then.
Okay, so let's continue and we'll stop again for more questions at some point.
Sure.
So like this is just one fun example of a cloud which we could understand to some extent, and so I wanted to show. So these are called mammatus clouds, which are like bulbous, you know, protrusions from clouds of this variety. So like these are not very rare. You keep watching in the sky and you'll see, like, you know, in most parts of the world, you'll see these bulbous protrusions from what is known as a cumulus anvil. So what causes this? This was a question that my student Kroor had asked, and he, my ex-student, I should say, and he could solve this problem. So, like, he showed that basically, like, when droplets descend from a cloud, these droplets are made, I mean, 1,000 times heavier than air, right? They're made of water. So they descend from a cloud, and as they descend, they evaporate, because here the air is unsaturated. And as they evaporate, there's evaporative cooling. So then this place becomes very cold compared to this place. And because of this evaporative cooling, you actually get like instabilities, because you have heavier air sitting on top of lighter air, and that is a kind of unstable scenario. So here is a place where, you know, in some, with quite a lot of analytical work, we could actually explain this. And we also proved the same thing in simulations. I'll show you just the simulation, because the analytical work is not possible to show in a short time. So we could actually simulate using this lovely, you know, code we have developed. I have not developed, Kroor and his colleagues, and basically the Rodham Narasimha group, they've developed. And we can use this code. It has Navier-Stokes, it has thermodynamics, and it solves for temperature and other components. And so from proper simulations, you see this kind of mammatus cloud formation. Okay, so what makes the Navier-Stokes interesting? One of the things is that at large Reynolds number, this constitutes what is called a singular perturbation problem. So, you know, like, people used to think initially that, you know, as the Reynolds becomes larger, 10 to the power 10, 10 to the power something, then I can actually throw away this term. So why don't I just throw away this term and solve this part, which is called the Euler equation, and life will be much more manageable, and I'll get almost the right answer. False. You do not get almost the right answer. You get nowhere near the right answer in many, many situations. And that is because Navier-Stokes are a singular perturbation problem. So just a few second introduction to singular perturbation. If you have a differential equation like this, where the highest derivative, and this is the highest derivative here, it's multiplied by the teeniest number epsilon. So suppose I have a second order equation, I have to satisfy two boundary conditions, right? If I throw away this epsilon term, just because epsilon is 10 to the power minus 20 or something, then I can only satisfy one boundary condition. So at one boundary or other, I'm going to be terribly wrong. And there are, you know, semi-analytical methods, even purely analytical methods, to handle these singular perturbation problems. And when you solve when you look at Navier-Stokes as a singular perturbation problem, you'll see many interesting features even in lamina flow, and even in, you know, the creation of instabilities from lamina to turbulent. One is that it's extremely sensitive to geometry. So, you know, like, when somebody is solved for a pipe flow, and you want to solve for a slightly different wedge flow or something, you may initially think that, oh, there's going to be no new physics in this because somebody solved for a shear flow which was nearly the same. Wrong. The answer can be very, very, can and most often is very, very different when you change the geometry. A tiny change in geometry in the pipe, you can get turbulence at, you know, Reynolds number of 2 or 10 instead of 2000. So extreme sensitivity to geometry is one, you know, resultant of this basic singular perturbation behavior. High sensitivity to things like composition, temperature. So 1 degree change in temperature, instead of 300, it's 301. It can make huge instabilities happen. Lots of things happen. And the consequent, when you change salinity, temperature, these things, and then the consequent stratifications you get in density and viscosity, they feed back into the Navier-Stokes in very singular ways. And that can change the answer quite a lot. So in our group, we've studied these things quite a lot, and I won't speak more about it. The second thing is, like, you know, when you think of a high Reynolds number flow, you think, oh, it's always turbulent. But that is not actually true. I'll show you one example here. There can be instabilities and, you know, something called transient growth, which I'll mention, and followed by further instabilities, or transient growth followed by secondary instabilities, and then that takes the flow to turbulence. The reverse can also happen. Turbulence can suddenly die and flow can re-laminarize. So, like, how does this happen? Why does this happen? These are all open questions, and why should we care? So this is just one example where, you know, we were part of a big collaboration. Ritabrat Thakur, he's my student who's just recently submitted his thesis. He studied this problem. So there was this mooring, which was an Indo-US study. So there was this mooring placed at somewhere around here in the Bay of Bengal. And this mooring is effectively a stick with many instruments on it, which measures things inside the bay. And then we left it there, and we have this special instrument called a Kaipod, which can measure turbulence. So we measure something, which we make some big approximations and pull out what we think is a turbulence level out of it. This is probably the first time turbulence has been measured in the Bay of Bengal. We left it there for more than a year, from 2014 December to 2016 February or something like this. So it was lying there, and it measured turbulence 50 times a second at 50 or 100 hertz, and it stayed that way for like 416 days. So, like, I'm showing time on this axis, and this is just a sketch I made, because if you see the real figures, I won't find it easy to explain the whole thing. So I'm here showing two lines. One was at 22 meters below the sea level, and one was at 55 meters below the sea level. So both of them are fairly shallow, somewhere near the surface of the ocean, okay? And so these two lines, where they were both turbulent, and turbulence level drops in the 55 and rises slightly in the 22. So initially, in the initial part of the signal, they were both nearly the same and turbulent, until the river water arrived in the monsoon season, and things started changing then. Now, what happens when the monsoon comes in is that winds start blowing like crazy over this part of the bay. So when winds are blowing like crazy, you'll think that turbulence will increase in the top part of the ocean. And that's actually what happened. The turbulence intensity marginally increased at 22 meters. But at 55 meters, once the top layer was fresher than the bottom layer, suddenly turbulence died. And you had practically laminar flow for 4 months. 4 months after the arrival of fresh water. We still don't understand this. Till now, it's only an observation for us. We're making lots of efforts to understand this thing. And after 4 months, it picks up and goes back to business as usual. So, like, you know, very strange signals are seen, and you know that monsoon itself is a very complicated ocean atmosphere feedback problem. So then, like, if the monsoon and the arrival of fresh water is doing this to the turbulence, what does this in turn do to, you know, evaporation? What does it do to everything else that we need for the monsoon? We don't know the answer. And remember, we've only measured it in one point at two depths. So, like, we need to do a lot more to understand this problem. So it's very relevant to now study instabilities and stabilization of these instabilities. And in order to study complex problems like this, where there is shear changes the answer completely. There's been a new paradigm. Some of it was developed like a few decades ago now, but some of it is being developed even as we speak, like in just the last few years. And this new paradigm is what we are trying to study. I will just take 5 minutes to explain this. So even if you've not followed the rest of the talk, you can start fresh at this point and listen. I want to give you an idea for why this instability is different from other instabilities. So like all of us know that if I take a pendulum and I keep its bob down, then it's a stable system. Like if I perturb it slightly, it'll come back to where it used to be. If I keep a pendulum ulta with the blob on top, it's unstable because that is at an equilibrium, but it's going to fall down. So we know our basic funda of stability and instability. And normally we'll write an equation of this type for the perturbation. It'll be U dot is some matrix A times U. U could be a big vector over all space and all of space and in three dimensions, three coordinates and everything. So we write a big matrix. We can solve such a system in a linear. So this could be linearized Navier-Stokes. It could be a simple equation for your pendulum or anything. You write this first order system and you solve for the eigenvalues of A. And depending on, let's say all the eigenvalues of A are negative. Let's take that case. Then my solution will look like some U1 e to the minus lambda 1, some U2 e to the minus lambda 2. And we can jump up and down and say, hey, this is a decaying solution. So it's a stable system. The whole of shear turbulence happens in a situation where the laminar is so-called stable. Where the laminar is in a stable state, the whole of shear turbulence happens. How can that happen? So how do we get growth in a stable system by a linear mechanism? And that is because this matrix A, whenever you have shear, is non-self-adjoint. And that means the eigenvectors you get, these U1s, U2s, and things that you solve for, these things are not orthogonal to each other. So I've drawn them in two dimensions, but they're actually like complicated, like very big n-dimensional system. N-dimensional eigenvectors, but they're not orthogonal to each other because A is not self-adjoint. And because of that, you see that suppose at zero time I had these two eigenvectors like this. This is just simple high school algebra. At zero time, it was at U1 and U2. And at some time T, the red guy has shrunk by till lambda 2 by some e to the lambda 2 factor. This red guy has shrunk by some other factor. Okay, so both of them have shrunk, but the resultant, which was here, has actually grown. So by this very simple high school thing, you can see that the resultant can grow when you have shear flow because the matrix that you're solving is non-self-adjoint. And in two dimensions itself, I've shown you growing by so much. In n dimensions, it can grow by factors of 1,000. So then this can actually kick non-linearity. So even if initially you had a quiet laminar flow, perturbations can grow and grow and grow by this method and lead you to turbulence. So you could have turbulence and laminar states coexisting with something like a basin boundary. So like a whole bunch of initial thing of the phase space, the entire phase space I've shown as one dot here, could go towards the laminar attractor or the turbulent attractor. Remember, the turbulent state is a very messy time-dependent state, but I've drawn this blob to represent the mean flow. So things can get attracted here. So these states can coexist and, you know, you can go from a one-well system for laminar flow to two wells where laminar is still more attractive to two wells where the turbulent becomes more attractive and things like this. So a very, very complicated laminar-turbulent coexistence which depends on instabilities can happen. And I won't explain what direct adjoint looping is, but I want to leave you with this thing that, you know, all these instabilities have their signature still in fully developed turbulence. All these instabilities are very messy. They're not simple eigenfunctions of anything. There's a huge combination of a very large number of eigenvectors. They go through, you know, they have certain shapes which go through again instabilities and instabilities, but you'll be amazed to see the structure. So I will just leave you with this thing which shows you that, you know, turbulence is not just white noise. There's a lot of structure in this very complicated chaotic system. So this is an example in a differentially heated channel, but that's you know, besides the point. So with that, I will conclude and say that there are many, many open questions in shear turbulence, particulate turbulence, in the transition to turbulence. And though we discussed only these three things, almost in anything that flows. Don't worry if you're a new researcher. Don't worry if the first paper you have to cite in this area was written in 1800. There will be some very basic thing that's left out, which is there for you to understand. And there'll be, like, you know, many complicated things left for you to understand. Of fundamental importance left for you. So I can guarantee that in almost any problem, like let it be in a micro channel or let it be in the universe, there'll be fluid mech problems that you can attack. It could be in sports, it could be in any field or anywhere that you see. There's fluid mechanics everywhere and questions everywhere. So thanks for your attention, and I'm happy to take questions now.
There are a couple of questions. How is turbulence studied at astronomical scales, say in galaxies, supernovae, etc.?
Okay, so like I'm totally not an expert there. So I can only give you some brief, summary. Basically, you know, you have a very complicated magneto-hydrodynamic turbulence going on in those situations. There are so many other forces like magnetic forces apart from the usual hydrodynamic forces. And then there's rotation, which gives additional terms. And there's like anisotropy. There is things which are, you know, totally in the compressible regime. So it's a completely harder ball game than here. The one thing I can tell you is that typically there are non-dimensional numbers there, a large number of non-dimensional numbers. We talked about the Reynolds number. There's also magnetic Reynolds number. There is various ratios of diffusivities, Schmidt numbers and Prandtl numbers. All of those in the real galactic situations are very, very large, and typically in simulations we can't go that large. So we study them at some different ranges of these non-dimensional numbers, and we hope that we are getting the correct answer in those things. But and there are situations where you can study it as a continuum.
There is one more general question. What are the applications of turbulence? Are there any places where turbulence is used for day-to-day life application?
Everywhere, like, you need to understand turbulence to understand anything. So recently, like, you've all been affected in some way or other by this lockdown and everything. You know that cough droplets spread. When I cough, I'm letting out a turbulent puff from my mouth. Even when I'm talking loudly like this, I'm doing that. So you guys are lucky that you're online and not sitting in front of me right now. So you know that the spread of cough drops, the spread of virus, everything depends on turbulence. This is one immediate example I can think of. If I put sugar in my tea and I stir it, that's, you know, something I need to understand. Everywhere in cooking, turbulence comes in. So, and instabilities come in. For example, you would have seen some beautiful bubble patterns on the top of your milk. In fact, like, you name a particular dish, and I'll tell you both turbulence questions and simple fluid dynamical questions in that dish. So there's a huge amount of fluid mech to be studied in food. So, like, when you're talking about daily life, like when I switch on my fan, I need to understand, you know, like when I was long ago, when we rented a house in Bangalore, there was a fan which was rotating the other way and it gave no air at all. And so, like, what does this tiny inclination of the wing do to produce turbulence? How is turbulence different if you, you know, open a window? Any of these things are like big questions in daily life.
There's one more question asking about the nature how we solve the problem without understanding the physics behind it fully. So, like, how do we model the systems without understanding the physics behind it fully?
Okay, so, like, it's hard. For example, in a cloud, there's so much physics going on due to evaporation and condensation, like I told you. And actually, we don't have an idea about how that's interacting with turbulence, what is happening really. But we come up with, you know, some simplifications that we think are realistic. So the whole idea is as follows. Take the most messy problem, make the most sensible things, sensible assumptions you can, which are all huge assumptions, and they may be terrible assumptions in some contexts, but they may be decent assumptions in other contexts. So then you make it, simplify it down and down and down to the simplest terms you can imagine. Try to solve that thing analytically. So in some limit, for example, Reynolds going to infinity, Reynolds going to zero, or some, you know, limit which you think is realistic for that problem, you solve it analytically, keep your analytical answer aside. Then there, like, you included the physics you think is important. So for that physics, you actually solved it, you actually understood it. Then you do a more messy computation where you release a few of these assumptions. And then you see how good are these matching. And wherever they're not matching, you start thinking about which is the physics you need to include. And you have to go up and up and up in complexity in this way.
Yeah. So when we study different systems for fluid dynamics, we observe a similar pattern at different scales, say in oceans or fluid in a cup. So why does this happen? What is the reason behind this structure?
Okay. So like in any of these nonlinear chaotic systems, one feature that comes out repeatedly is that of a multifractal system. So let's talk of fractals. You know that fractals are objects which have non-integer dimensions. In turbulence, if I pull out vorticity of a certain magnitude, or if I pull out various other features like that, I'll see that they occupy non-integer dimensions. So they'll be between 2 and 3 typically. And one of the properties of such a nonlinear system is that if I look at this at one scale, and then I look at it at a smaller scale and zoom out, and I look at it at an even smaller scale and zoom out, there'll be a whole range of scales where the pattern will look identical. So one way to imagine this, why this happens in turbulence is the following. So imagine your washing machine, okay? In your washing machine, let's say you have a rotating drum. So you're putting your clothes in, you're putting your water and soap, and you're switching it on. Now, if it moved in solid body rotation, if the whole fluid moved in solid body rotation, then the soap will go in, you know, circular lines, and your clothes are not going to get clean. In order to clean your clothes, you need turbulence. So then, like, what happens is that at the largest scale, the flow remembers that it is not isotropic. It's a drum which is rotating in a particular direction. But as energy goes down and down and down into scales, you know that the big scale is going to now force all the smaller scales. As it goes down, it forgets where it came from. It forgets that it was in this kind of rotation. So it could be in an aircraft wing or in your washing machine. In the smaller scale, it becomes homogeneous and isotropic. That's a property of turbulence. And in this homogeneous and isotropic thing, all scales are similar to all other scales. So if I zoom in and magnify, I'll get very, very similar pictures. So this is one reason for self-similarity. If I'm not clear, please come back to me with further questions.
How is human crowd behavior modeled as turbulence?
How is human crowd behavior modeled as turbulence? I don't know if it can be modeled as turbulence, but it can be modeled because like it can be modeled as active turbulence, I should say. A crowd of humans are active particles. They're not quite like turbulence. I mean, I can't put Navier-Stokes for them for the simple reason that each human has an engine inside him or her. So it's not just an external force that's driving them. Even without an external force, I can get up and start running around. I can slow down. I can do all of that. So humans and traffic flow and bacteria or whatever, because of the internal engines, they're like they're a different kind of turbulence. So when they are in a flow, when there's like, you know, flow elements made up of these things, the physics and the equations can be very different. So I'll have to study them under that kind of equations. And I'm not even sure that human crowds can be turbulence in any sense. They can be very chaotic, yes. But will they be vortical? Will they have any of the properties that go with what we call as turbulence, with structures at different scales? I don't know about that.
There is one question asking about the effect of viscosity on turbulence.
Okay, so basically we know that as viscosity goes down, down and down, the Reynolds number goes up, up and up. And a thumb rule is that turbulence intensity goes up, up and up. This depends on the composition, the, you know, geometry and so many other things. But in general, the intensity of turbulence goes up as the viscosity goes down. So, but still, what happens is that at the smallest scale, as you go down and down and down in scale, at some tiniest scale, viscosity will play a very important role. So, like, you know, when you run your washing machine, let's go back to that example. I'm feeding energy at this scale and it's dissipating at a very, very small scale into heat. So, like, those are called the Kolmogorov scales. So, if your viscosity is smaller and smaller and smaller, the ratio of these scales goes up, up and up. So dissipation happens at an even smaller scale, but somewhere all the energy gets dissipated. So viscosity has many important roles. Besides this, viscosity is very, very important near walls because there's boundary layer behavior. There's all the singular perturbation stuff is determined by viscosity. So, and if there are small variations in that viscosity, that can change the kind of singular nature of turbulence of the Navier-Stokes. And so like there's a huge range of situations where viscosity is important. Viscosity is important to start any vortex. So even if you think of, you know, the big vortices as, you know, their dynamics as being primarily inviscid, they could never have been set up without, you know, a big churning action for which you need viscosity.
Droplets in clouds carry charges. How these charges are affected by turbulence inside the clouds, like thunderstorm clouds, does this affect the charge distribution?
Yeah, so this is a very nice open problem. We don't understand it very well. In fact, my student who did this Mammatus cloud work and lots of other cloud work, Kroor, whose real name is Ravichandran, he is now looking at lightning. And lightning is completely not clearly well understood problem. So we know that huge charge separation takes place and suddenly a discharge takes place. But the mechanism is not, at least to me, it's totally unclear. And I think most of it is not understood. And yes, like it could be affecting turbulence and turbulence will be affecting it. And we don't know. We don't know how yet.
There is one question about how to approach research in fluid mechanics. When we start, we see a lot of developments made by pure mathematicians. So that's why it's difficult to follow classical papers and books. So what is an optimal way to do research in fluid mechanics?
I think like a good first book to read will be Tritton's book, which is Physical Fluid Dynamics. There's another book by Faber called Fluid Dynamics for Physicists. So these are books, and Landau-Lifshitz, these are all books written with physicists in mind, and so they won't be so highly mathematical and you'll be able to follow quite a lot. And it's also very good to do basic experiments. If you, you know, play with, you know, fluid dynamics in the kitchen, fluid dynamics in daily life, set up simple experiments, look at, you know, how sand can go through instabilities, all of those things are very nice, and you start by writing simple equations to explain the simple things you're seeing. So this is a very good way to study, I mean, or to get excited about fluid mechanics.
There is a follow-up question to this. How to keep physically realizing things in fluid mechanics without feeling a bit lost in the mathematics when they go advanced into the field?
Yeah. It takes some time, but you get into it. Like, finally, you know, in any research problem, it's a process of learning. There's no hidden magic in it. And as you go forward, you see, like, you learn from your seniors things that you can do, and then you slowly become confident to venture out into some harder questions, and you do the maths. And it helps to have brilliant colleagues and brilliant people around you. Like, I mean, one example is my colleague Vishal Vasan, who taught me so much about this special method called unified transform method, which we could use to solve, you know, some physical problem that I had, and I could have never reached that place. So yeah, it's a process of dialogue and learning. So nothing to be very scared of. Maths and physics go hand in hand. And engineering also. I'm an engineer.
Thank you, Professor. Now I request Abhip sir to give word of thanks.
Thanks so much.
Right. So first of all, we would like to thank Professor Rama Govindarajan for accepting our invitation, taking the time out of her day to give this extremely intriguing talk about fluid dynamics and the beautiful chaos as well as structure to turbulence and how to go about modeling it. I think there are some interesting questions here, and I would like to thank you, ma'am, for helping us realize this.
Thank you.
We would also like to thank the Dean of the IISc UG program, Professor P.S. Anil Kumar, for making these talks possible. We would like to thank Team Pravega for their support in the organization of these talks. And lastly, we would like to thank you, the audience, for attending this talk, and we hope you enjoyed it. If you did, Pravega is hosting a bunch of other talks, which you can check out on pravega.org. The next talk is tomorrow, in fact, at 5 p.m. It's an elementary lecture series chemistry talk on organic stereochemistry by Shantanu Mukherjee of IISc. As for coherence lecture series, we will be back soon. So till then, stay safe and take care.
Thank you. Bye.